TheDailyMass.com. Experience the Roman Catholic Mass from historic St. Louis Cathedral every day on TheDailyMass.com. His love, anywhere in the world.
Good evening, I'm Sarah McDonald.
And I'm Jason Angelette. Welcome to Issues in Faith. Now, Sarah, this week, as we're in Lent, the rite of Christian initiation for adults also starts this week, right? It's been going on, but there's something special going on this particular week, am I correct?
Right, actually this past weekend, and then also on Tuesday night of this week on the North Shore, Archbishop Amen had a special ceremony. The Order of Catechumens candidates to the first formal step for those entering the Catholic Church at Easter to begin their process.
So these are people who are not Catholic and they wanted to be Catholic, and so this is the first step that they're taking to go down that journey.
Right, and there are two different groups of people who will be entering the church at Easter, candidates and catechumens. Some have been baptized and are looking for full communion with the church, and some are going to be baptized, receive communion, and be confirmed all at Easter Vigil Mass. And many people are familiar with that process, and then they're also familiar with some of the steps, but don't realize that it's actually a formal process for the Lenten season liturgically.
And it's broken down in three parts, is that correct?
That's right, there are three scrutinies, and again, we're referencing Catholic Answers again this week to help form our viewers, but there are three scrutinies that appear, and that is the third, fourth, and fifth Sundays of Lent during Mass. And so many times people forget that this is happening, and then after the homily or so, the priest will call up everybody and they'll go through the scrutiny. But that's an important part of the process of becoming, of a rite of initiation.
Right.
Because being Catholic is not an individual, enclosed thing. It's about community.
Fantastic. And so what is the first one that's coming up? What's the first scrutiny?
Well, again, the first scrutiny will be the third Sunday of Lent. So we're coming up on our second one. So next week, throughout the churches throughout the Archdiocese will be welcoming out their candidates and catechumens. They'll go through a process where they ask them, are you here freely? And their formation is ongoing.
Yes.
But this is their first formal introductions into the Mass setting. Like you said, very often some church parishes will invite those going through RCI to stay through the celebration. Mm-hmm. Some will, they will leave formally the celebration of the Mass to continue on with their classes. But it's a witness for all of us at the time as we're there and witnessing the scrutinies.
Sure.
For us to scrutinize our own faith lives to recall our baptismal promises. And again, we're going to do this again with the Easter Vigil and throughout Easter, but nothing about being Catholic is insular.
Yeah.
And I think that's something that is very, very important, as especially in today's times, that we are proud of our faith, that we are willing to share our faith, and working with our parishes as they work through the RCA program is an excellent way to that. And we have over 400 people.
That's
in
beautiful.
The Archdiocese.
It just goes to show you that the evangelizing is still something central to our to who we are as in our Catholic faith. Christ had to go and preach the gospel and to baptize and to call people into the faith. And so we're doing that. And just to continue to our Holy Father for Lent, I read a message that he encouraged us to strengthen our brothers and sisters in Christ and calling them to the church, and I think this is a beautiful way that the church does that, to educate them in faith and to help guide and form their understanding of Christ and the church and all that.
That's right, and again, like I was saying, we have over 400 people on both the South Shore and the North Shore, and all age groups, all ethnicities, a very diverse group of people, and the stories are so important. Because people come from all walks of life to become Catholic, and when you ask them what they are, one of the scrutinies asks, what are you seeking? You're seeking the truth.
Amen.
And that's what our Catholic faith needs, we need to be proud of, is that as Catholics, we are always constantly seeking the truth.
And thank you, Sarah. Tonight, we're focusing on a special committee of the Archdiocese, the Committee for Racial Harmony. We have several special guests that have dedicated their time to working on this issue since Archbishop Alfred Hughes released his pastoral letter on racial harmony in 2007. Sarah sits down first with Committee Chair Honorable Joseph Giarrusso and committee member Sister Teresa Maria Tran.
Well, thank you both for being with us, Sister Teresa Marie and Judge Giarrusso.
Thank you.
Well, I want to get started, and we're having a whole show tonight focused on the Committee for Racial Harmony and its message, but I want to get started by asking you both, how did you get involved with this very special ministry within our Archdiocese?
Sister?
It was about 6 years ago when I received a letter from our former Archbishop Hughes. And based on my experience, and I felt like it was a good time and a good opportunity for me to be part of the committee and to help to promote racial harmony in the diocese.
Judge Giarrusso.
I had just retired as a magistrate at Criminal District Court, and I knew Brian Jackson. And I violated a cardinal rule that I had set for myself when I retired, which is that I'm not going to volunteer for anything. But I did. I called Brian Jackson and said, this interests me. I see you're the chairperson. I think I'd like to get involved and help if I could. And thereafter, I received a letter from the Archbishop as well, then Archbishop Hughes, and decided I would serve. And I think that there were primarily two reasons that I really wanted to volunteer and serve. One is I was a child, as growing up in the 60s. I grew up with desegregation and watching the evolution from desegregation to even more of an embracing of our brothers and sisters. I got to see something that a lot of people also didn't see. My father was superintendent of police then, who at one point had to enforce segregation laws, and then in the same breath, a year or two later, desegregation rules so children could go to school and to go ahead and to work and protect those children. And that really impressed me. And what really impressed me is I got to see something you don't get to see often, which is someone's own development of heart and mind. And my father then just set an example for me from that point on about how this was an evil that had to be dealt with, that everyone has a right to be treated equally. And I think also, as I grow, the church speaks to me on this as well. You look at Jesus' admonition and question in the gospel, who is my neighbor? You look at Vatican II, which stresses the worth and dignity of every human being. You look at Vatican II, which says we have all of us have a call to universal holiness. Mm-hmm. And the bishop's statement, American bishops on racism. All these things are things that I think touch the mind and heart and want us to deal with this.
And that brings up to my memory, a couple months ago we did some taping, and mm-hmm. soon we're going to be launching videos in which you will both give testimonials about your background and why you've worked in this ministry. And there's a lot more to that story that yes. you just mm-hmm. told. But Sister Teresa Marie, what has, in your background, led you to feel like this was good? And how has your faith impacted your decision to work on this committee, as Judge Giarrusso sort of led into this discussion?
Living during the war in Vietnam and also escaping Vietnam to find freedom. And when I came over here, being a newcomer, living among Americans, has helped me to trust that, you know, no matter what happens, God is there and things will get better. And so when I experience some mistreatment or misunderstanding in regard to culture or language, I guess I just trust that things will get better. Believe that because of the past, my resiliency is very strong.
And I think that's something that a lot of people might ask, why do we need this type of committee within the Archdiocese and you know, focusing on the universal church? But you hit on a point. Those misunderstandings, so often conflict arises from misunderstandings, and that's a part of what this committee tries to fight, and fight's a strong word, but tries to combat within our society, help educating about those things.
Exactly, because, you know, when I first came, there was a lot of time that I was misunderstood. And I realized that because I did not know the person or the culture, and there was a fear in me, so that I would either evade the person or not to deal with it, or there was a fear in there. But as I got to know the person, the culture, or their background, then we became friends, and not to, you know, stay away or even to judge them or to treat them differently.
Sure.
Yeah.
What do you both see as some of the things that you're most proud of as far as working with the committee, Commissioner Harmony?
You know, I think on picking up the theme of understanding that we realize that it's not just about dialogue, but we don't just talk with each other. We do things with each other. And so much more gets accomplished, so much more gets shared when you not just speak to one another, but when you do things with one another. I think one of the things that's been heartening and one of the things that we work on is to try to encourage the schools and more particularly the parishes to truly understand that we're not asking them to participate with this on an ad hoc basis. Don't just form a committee to deal with this. But this is truly, as you said in your opening, it's a ministry. It is an ongoing ministry. It is one that'll be present with us as long as there are parishes. So we continue to understand and to grow and to develop with one another. So I think one of the more heartening things that I've seen over the past couple of years is parishes beginning to embrace this whole idea of a ministry and setting up their own ministry, their own racial harmony ministry within their parish to minister to one another, to grow with one another, to accept the diversity within the parish.
Very good.
And I think what I feel proud of to be part of this committee is that, you know, after we were being trained as facilitators, and so groups of us, committee members, would go to different parishes and then to kind of train other people. We are talking about to think differently or to, in a way, inform them that, you know, by getting to know the other person, by getting to know the other culture, their background, we will have a better understanding and better respect. And, as, you know, just at the end, to appreciate the gifts that each culture bring and each nationality offer. And so I think, you know, our committee have been doing that in different parishes and different schools. So I think that's something we should be proud of.
I agree. I think it's something you should be proud of is a central ministry and essential providers for this ministry and leaders within the Archdiocese. And you can tell from the things that as you talk about what you're proud of, you can tell this is a ministry that you want to see going and enduring into the future. And I want to, you know, thank you both for your leadership roles with this committee and for seeing the work of Archbishop Hughes in his pastoral letter through to now. So thank you both for being with us tonight.
Thank you for having
us. Thank you.
And we'll be right back with more members of our Racial Harmony Committee.
The science of learning is an imperfect one, but Louisiana Catholic schools have consistently instituted a formula for success. An astonishing 95% of Catholic school students go on to college. And last year, they brought with them over $185 million in scholarship awards. Shouldn't you invest in success and the confident leaders of tomorrow? Louisiana Catholic Schools, in a class of their own.
I'm here today inside historic St. Louis Cathedral, a place where WLAE has broadcast the daily mass for more than 25 years.
A recent PBS ruling ensures that this valuable service will continue on WLAE for those looking for daily inspiration, and for the many who are homebound or in our area hospitals who can't attend Mass. But in order to continue to provide the Mass every day, we need your financial support now more than ever. I'm asking you to please consider donating today. We have numerous partnership opportunities available. For as little as $32 a month, you can help fund the televising of the daily Mass, a program that lifts the spirit and enriches the lives of so many of our viewers. And for a donation of $50 or more, we will send you this beautiful signed poster of St. Louis Cathedral as our gift. Please send your contributions to WLAE-TV, 3330 North Causeway Boulevard, Metairie, Louisiana, 7002, or to donate online, log on to WLAE.com and click on the picture of St. Louis Cathedral. For more information on partnership opportunities, call 504-866-7411. At WLAE, we've worked hard to keep the Mass on the air. Now we need your financial support to keep it going. I know that you'll help us if you can. Thank you, and God bless.
Mrs. Sal Longoria, thank you very much for being with us. And Dr. Derek Riveras,
yes,
thank you very much for being with us. Now, Racial Harmony Committee, y'all are on this committee. How did y'all come to work here with this committee particularly?
I personally was appointed by Archbishop Hughes.
Fantastic.
I got a letter when he, after the pastoral letter came out, and he wanted to form the committee to implement the Racial Harmony letter. I guess because of my involvement with the Hispanic Apostolate and other Hispanic ministries, he had sent me a letter, and I was more than happy to become a member of the committee.
That's the exact same way, a letter from the Archbishop.
So how did it feel getting the opening up the letter one day from the Archbishop and hearing the specific requirement that he, or request, that he wants y'all to be on board with this? How was that for y'all?
I mean, at that point, I had done a few things with the Archdiocese, so I figured, you know, this would be just one more role that I could, you know, could provide some service and some assistance. Racial Harmony is something that I do professionally as well, so it wasn't a stretch at all. It was something I was more than willing to do.
And so, for me, I was just so happy to help Archbishop Hughes because, you know, he's got a special place in my heart, and anything he wanted me to do, I was going to do.
Awesome. Praise God. So how has your faith particularly influenced the work that y'all do?
It's crucial.
Yeah.
It's crucial. I think part of the mission of our committee is putting our faith on the street and letting people know that we are one church, that we are one people, and it's so important, especially in this archdiocese and in this country, with the diversity of our church, that we realize that we're all one.
Amen.
And I think that's really the message of our committee, so to speak.
How about for yourself?
And for me, growing up Black and Catholic many times was a challenge. Not here in New Orleans, but my father was military, so we traveled around a bit.
Yeah.
And to be the only Black parishioner and people assuming that I wasn't familiar with the Mass or was I a guest after repeated attendance, it's been a challenge. And so I know that if it's been a challenge for me, it's been a challenge for others of different races. And so part of the goal of the committee is to bring the races together, but also it's an opportunity for us to celebrate each of our differences as well.
Amen. What has been something for you that has been something that you're most proud of being a part of this this committee?
You know, for me, the biggest impact or the biggest positive for me at this point has been meeting people like Derek, has been that this committee has brought together Catholic African Americans, Catholic Latinos, Catholic Asian Americans, and really, I think, for the first time, put us all together so that we can do something great for the Archdiocese and for the Church. And the friendships and the bonds that I have established through this committee in terms of meeting people like Derek and Sister Teresa, and I think the impetus is there for bigger and better things, and to get that message out through a diverse face.
Fantastic.
I was going to say something corny, but now that you say that, man, I got to say it because I got to meet Sal. But yeah, that is certainly a great byproduct, meeting folks from different faiths, different ethnicities and races who share the same faith. That has been powerful. And this guy and we're connected. I don't know how, you know, we've got an uncle somewhere, but
probably
a common uncle somewhere. But, you know, there have been a couple of great accomplishments for me. One is the twinning parishes that we've been able to try and get parishes that look different to come together and to worship in the same faith traditions, and to experience those differences. That's been pretty cool. And then our liturgical celebration that we do annually, where we get folks from all over to come out, that's been pretty powerful too.
Praise God. Well, I know there's also good times, and there's also probably struggles that go along with the ministry. What has been something that's been, I guess, disappointing being a part of the ministry?
You know, it's hard to figure a disappointment because we're not the committee hasn't been in existence that long, and I really think we've accomplished a lot, like those racial harmony celebrations. But if anything, I think, you know, it's just sometimes we're preaching to the choir in terms of who's listening to our message, who's coming to our events.
Sure.
And, you know, it's always a challenge to get the message of unity and the message of the gospel to the general public, to everybody that's sitting out in the pews. You know, sometimes we notice that for our racial harmony celebrations and stuff, that we're getting the same people, the Just Faith people,
right,
or people that have attended prior events. And I think it's just kind of disseminating that message of unity into the general Catholic population.
Would you agree with that?
I would have to agree.
Yeah.
Our biggest challenge is getting more people involved. And I think Sal hit the nail on the head. The people that are participating pretty well get it.
Yeah.
Whatever the it is.
Right.
The folks that we're trying to reach, I think we're just going to have to extend our nets wider. And we're doing some of that through some of this broadcast,
yeah,
for instance,
right,
is an opportunity for others to see that we are working at harmony within the church. Some of the other publications that the Clarion Herald has run a series of articles that both Sal and I have written a piece for, and several other members of the committee have written. And so we've got my biggest hope for the committee would be to get this word out to those who don't get it.
Sure, sure.
And I think we made some strides. I mean, there's some folks who, with the 20 parishes, who never encountered folks that didn't look
Absolutely.
Like themselves.
Yeah.
And now encountering them, you know, their eyes are open and say, hey, you know, these folks worship just like I do.
That's right.
You know,
That's
they're
right.
struggling with the changes to the Mass, just like we're struggling
right.
with the changes to the Mass.
That's right. That's right. Well, what are some other positive things that y'all have experienced in working together? And what are some things that, you talk about communication, what are something that you'd like to announce, like things that's going on right now, or how can people get involved? What can people do, volunteer, any of those types of things? This is your chance to kind of make that plea.
I was just going to say, you know, we just talked about the 20 parishes and we talked about the racial harmony celebration. I would say to any and everyone to broaden your worship experience by visiting another church that's not like yours.
Yeah.
Visiting in another ethnic faith tradition that's similar to yours, I mean, the same faith tradition, but an ethnic group that's different from yours, and see how similar their worship is, or see how different it is, and either appreciate it or at least celebrate it.
Right.
But to get out of the box of, you know, I'm going to the same, you know, we were talking earlier, I'm going to the same 9:15 Mass, I go to it every Sunday, I'm not going to anybody else's church. Get out and see just how broad our reach is.
And as we grow, we have a lot more activities. We have prayer breakfast, we have days of reflection, we have the racial harmony celebration every year, usually in September. There's a lot of ways to get involved. The Office of Racial Harmony is on the Archdiocesan website. We have an office on Howard Avenue run by Sister Teresa Rooney, our great leader.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of ways to get involved. And we're a very open committee and very welcoming.
Absolutely.
So anybody who wants to come to our meetings and become a member of our group.
Someone wants to help out with a prayer breakfast, organize, help plan something, they can call y'all
Absolutely.
Up and to be
Absolutely.
A part of it.
We'd love it.
Yeah.
Well, guys, thank y'all so much for being with us.
Thank
it's
you for
a,
having
it's a
us.
Pleasure to be with y'all, and thank you so much for what you do for the Archdiocese and for our area. So God bless you.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Sal,
thanks for having us.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Again, you can learn more about the Office of Racial Harmony online at www.archdiocese-no.org.
Never forget our best teachers, the ones who do so much more than teach. They inspire and insist we bring our best in everything we do. We find those mentors in our Catholic schools. It's why Catholic school graduates consistently go on to college, land better jobs, embrace faith,
and the lead. Louisiana Catholic Schools, in a class of their own.
Mardi Gras rolled through a West Bank school the other day with an unusual twist and a big roar. The kids at Immaculate Conception Elementary were treated to a reading from an author and storyteller who reached far into the past for this timely literacy lesson. Janet Gross has the story.
Obviously, something fun was happening here at Immaculate Conception with masks and doubloons and getting out of class. And if that wasn't enough, there were dinosaurs.
How many of you like dinosaurs? Now I want you to give me your biggest, best T-Rex roar. Ready? Good job.
Children's author Diane de las Casas has tossed a little T-Rex action into the Mardi Gras mix with her newest book. Inspired by her nephew's school project, this float made out of shoeboxes, she has the prehistoric parading in dinosaur Mardi Gras.
Around the corner and down the street, the dinos move to the mambo beat.
And like any good storyteller, she gets the kids into it.
Dinosaur Mardi Gras, chomp, chomp. Dinosaur Mardi Gras, stomp, stomp. Down in New Orleans.
As the author of 18 children's books and counting, she knows the value of reading, even when the pictures have to help the words.
It has to start very basic. Kids have to start reading at a very basic level, and that begins with picture books. And even though they can't always read all the words, they can gather the context of the story through the illustrations. So the words and the pictures go together. And this is the building blocks. These are the building blocks of literacy.
And you know, some of the minds behind these masks are already building.
You know those long books with only pages and words? When I'm older, I'm going to start reading them so I can learn lots of things and I want to be rich.
There's no stopping them with that kind of enthusiasm. And that zeal for learning is something they encourage here all the time.
See, everything we do here, we try to have an academic spin to it. So even though she was talking about Mardi Gras, if you realize her presentation was a science lesson on dinosaurs as well as reading.
Ready, boys?
De las Casas works to make sure that's a part of her books, Stories with Lanya.
This also translates across the curriculum, because if you look at the book, there's social studies, there's the study of Mardi Gras culture, there's dinosaurs, so there's a science tie-in. There's drama and theater, and I actually have a story theater script for this on my website, so teachers can act it out with their students. So all of these things come into play to make it more than just reading the book, that there is value added, and that is what enhances literacy.
Captivating them now helps lead to lifelong learners and readers.
You can learn from stuff when the story, the story's trying to teach you stuff, and you could learn about it.
So on this day, reading, parading, really getting involved in the book leaves behind more than a story. It's an adventure. And the adventure these kids read about helps them dream about the story that will be their lives.
I want to be a soldier.
A soldier?
Okay. Actually a cop, because the army stuff, it's a little bit too hard. The cop, I'm going to serve justice. I'm going to catch some robbers and make sure they don't hurt anybody.
So many possibilities. And sometimes it all starts with words and pictures in a book. Adventures that jump off the page and into a parade. I'm Janet Gross for Issues and Faith.
The author who travels the world with her books chose to bring her newest book to life at Immaculate Conception because of her close ties with the school. Her daughter is a student there.
And if you have a question for us or have an idea for a story you'd like to see on air, write to us at Issues and Faith, 3330 North Causeway Boulevard, Suite 345, Metairie, Louisiana, 70002, or email us at questions@wlae.com. Plus, if you missed an episode, you can catch up online at www.archdiocese-no.org. And that's our program for this evening. For all of us at Issues in Faith, thanks for watching.
We'll be back next week. Hope you join us again soon. Until then, bye.